Hi friends, welcome back to vlsifab. Today we will be going to discuss about low power design, its importance, clock gating, power gating and different techniques used in low power design. Guys, if you have not subscribed the channel yet, kindly subscribe it to get all the latest technology node related videos, and also give your feedback in the comment section for the scope of improvement. Guys, please watch till last and let's start the video without wasting time. So what is the need of low power design? So the need for low power design is also becoming a major issue in high performance digital systems such as microprocessors, digital signal processors, DSPs and other applications. So increasing chip density and the higher operating speed lead to the design of very complex chips with high clock frequencies. If the clock frequency of the chip increases, then the power dissipation of the chip also increases, and thus the temperature increases linearly. So since the dissipated heat must be removed effectively to keep the chip temperature at an acceptable level, the cost of packaging, cooling and heat removal becomes a significant factor. Low power design of digital integrated circuits has emerged as a very active and rapidly developing field of CMOS design. So in this slide you can see that with the passing years how the leakage power is increasing, and significantly as the technology node shrinks due to scaling, leakage power is also become a major concern for the designers to think for. So looking at the individual components of power as illustrated by the equation in the given slides, the goal of low power design is to reduce the individual components of power as much as possible, thereby reducing the overall power consumption. The power equation contains components for dynamic and static power. Dynamic power is comprised of switching and short circuit power, whereas static power is comprised of leakage or current that flows through the transistor when there is no activity. The value of each power component is related to any of the following factors such as activity, frequency, transition time, capacitive load, voltage, leakage current, peak current. For example, the higher the voltage, the higher the power consumed by each component, resulting in higher overall power. Conversely, the lower the voltage, the lower the overall power. To achieve the best performance with the lowest power consumption, trade-off for each of these different factors are tried and tested via various low power techniques and methodologies. So this is the typical low power design flow. And as I'm not from front end, so I will be talking mostly about the PD part. So the implementation team generates a gate level design representation and creates a physical design which captures the design intent. In previous chip geometries, 130 nm and above, power distribution via a single chip wide network was usually sufficient. But in today's design, upward of 20 different power networks may be needed, with appropriate level shifters and isolation logic between the domains. The challenge at this stage is that synthesis, place and route tools have not matured sufficiently in their comprehension of complex power management schemes and can't be relied upon to automatically specify the best physical implementation. For example, physical design tools attempt to automate the implementation of clock gating, but such tools only operate on explicit enables, one which the designer has already specified. But many explicit enables in the design may achieve only a small power savings. In some cases, depending on the activity statistics, adding a clock gate may even increase the power. Implementation tool often swamp the clock tree synthesis with a large number of ineffective enables. Typically, significant manual intervention by physical designer is therefore required to save significant power with clock gating schemes. Most run an automatic gating mechanism blindly and accept whatever result it generates. Some power management techniques can only be applied at the gate level and during the implementation phase. Most technology libraries include two or more BT levels to allow trading off performance versus leakage. This swapping is typically done late in the implementation process. The technique can be generalized to allow any transistor, any gate sizing, gate resizing. This includes aggressive resizing for power recovery, and advanced implementation techniques like empty CMOS and SRPG are also emerging for designs where standby power is a key concern. So here I have listed few of the power reduction techniques for dynamic and leakage power, out of which today we will be discussing shortly on clock gating, power gating, power gating with retention flops. So guys, please watch till end to get all the concepts of low power design. So low power design is very much important in the current scenario, as the power is considered as the most important constraints in the embedded systems, and low power design is essential in high performance systems and portable systems. So these are the power reduction techniques for dynamic and leakage power, out of which today we will be discussing mainly on clock gating, power gating, retention flops and other keywords related to low power design. So generally, key focus on SoCs is to reduce power consumption in the circuit and the signal which is being used for the longest period of time tends to consume the largest power. In a SoC or CPU or GPU, the clock tends to be the longest signal and is being toggled periodically to operate all the modules of the circuit. Hence, clock gating is a popular technique for reducing the clock signal, thereby reducing the power consumption by shutting off the clock modules when not being used by using an enabled signal. Clock gating is not a new concept and has been in use since the mid-1990s to reduce power consumption. At every active edge of the clock, circuit switches to a stable state, adding to the power consumption of the circuit. Idea is to disable the clock for the time when the related design portions not in use. It helps in saving switching power. So there are two types of clock gating styles available. They are latch-based clock gating and latch-free clock gating. The latch-free clock gating style uses a simple AND or OR gate. Here, if enable signal goes inactive in between the clock pulse or if it multiple times, then gated clock output either can terminate prematurely or generate multiple clock pulses. This restriction makes the latch-free clock gating style inappropriate for our single clock flip-flop based design. Now the latch-based clock gating. The latch-based clock gating style adds a level-sensitive latch to the design to hold the enable signal from the active edge of the clock until the inactive edge of the clock. Since the latch captures the state of the enable signal and holds it until the complete clock pulse has been generated, the enable signal needs only be stable around the rising edge of the clock, just as in traditional ungated design style. Now we are going to discuss another technique that is called multi-voltage for low power design. So this is a technique where functions of a chip are partitioned via performance characteristics. Perhaps one block is in high performance while the rest of the chip is in lower performance, as shown in the figure. To achieve the goals for the high performance block, a higher voltage is typically required. While to save power on the lower performance blocks, a lower voltage can be used. This is in lieu of designing the entire block at the higher voltage, which is simpler but more power intensive. In the power equation, voltage is reduced, which decreases every static and dynamic power component. With multi-voltage design, there is a complication of designing in separate voltage islands, where voltage crossing between islands may require level shifter cells, with the need to implement and analyze the blocks at their different voltage characteristics. So what is level shifter? So level shifter cells are special standard cells used in multi-voltage designs to convert one voltage level to another. As multi-voltage designs have more than one voltage domain, level shifters are used for all the signals crossing from one voltage domain to another voltage domain. Like isolation cells, level shifters are inserted by the synthesis tools. So there are two types of level shifters. There are low to high level shifters and high to low level shifters. So low to high level shifters are used for signals crossing from a lower voltage domain to higher voltage domain. It basically amplifies the source signal so that it can be interpreted properly in the destination domain. Suppose a 0.7 volt signal is crossing from 0.7 volt voltage domain to 1 volt voltage domain. Now in the lower voltage domain, it corresponds to logic 1, but in higher voltage domain, it is neither logic 1 nor logic 0. So the signal becomes unknown or X in the absence of low to high level shifters. Then from high to low level shifters are used for signal crossing from higher voltage domain to lower voltage domain. It basically attenuates the source signal. Although putting a level shifter for signal crossing from a higher voltage domain to lower voltage domain is optional, as signal will be interpreted properly in the destination domain. But typically we put a level shifter to avoid stress on the transistors of lower voltage domain due to high voltage of the source signal. So the next technique for low power design is power gating. Power gating is a technique used in integrated circuit design to reduce power consumption by shutting off the current to blocks of the circuit that are not in use. Power gating is used to save the leakage power when the system is not in operation. This is accomplished by adding a switch either to VDD or VSS supply. When the design is power gated, it literally means that the block is power off. Powering off a design block is the most beneficial technique of all the low power techniques because you dissipate near zero power because the switching circuit used for implementing power gating still dissipate leakage power even in power gating mode. The control to the power gating switching circuit is generated by the power gating control block. So in this context, we will be discussing about the isolation cells. Isolation cells are additional cells inserted by the synthesis tools for isolating the buses or wires crossing from power gated domain of a circuit to its always on domain. The isolation list is a list which consists of all the buses or wires that needs isolation cells. The isolation list, we specify the clamping value of the nets as logic 0 or logic 1, and accordingly the synthesis tool will insert isolation cells. So what is retention resistors? These cells are special flops with multiple power supply. They are typically used as a shadow resistor to retain its value even if the block in which it's residing is shut down. All the paths leading to this resistor need to be always on, and hence special care must be taken to synthesize or place or route them. When design blocks are switched off for sleep mode, data in all flip-flops contained within the block will be lost. If the designer desires to retain state, retention flip-flop must be used. The retention flops has the same structure as standard flop. However, the retention flop has a balloon latch that is connected to always on VDD. In normal mode, the state saving latch will not be active. active. Just before power down, the value in the regular flip-flop will be transferred to the state saving register, and the power to the regular register will be shut down. The power to the state saving latch should be maintained, and thus it keeps the register state. Thank you guys for watching the video. If you want to get this kind of VLSI related videos, please like, share and subscribe the channel VLSI Fab. Also, please comment your doubts and suggest the topics for the next video. Thank you.